One of the reasons that I'm most curious about Mars is I want to understand what makes a good habitable planet. Why do some planets sustain life for billions of years, teeming with life like our own Earth? Mars once had an environment that was much more hospitable to life, but then it as a planet lost it. Why? What happened? Why did it change? By exploring these sister worlds, we really learn something about how fragile the balance can be.
Because it tells us how rare or how common places like Earth are in the universe.
Houston, Endeavour, roll program.
Join me as we look into some of the space explorations that so excite us and have such promise for improving man's environment that we dare not ignore them.
Right now is one of the most exciting decades for space exploration, where some of this science fiction about having humans in space on the moon, on Mars, I think that that's starting to become a reality. My name is Bethany Ehlmann. I'm a professor of planetary science, and I do research at the NASA Jet Propulsion Laboratory, where we operate the rovers on Mars.
Touchdown confirmed. Safely on the surface of Mars.
I'm fortunate to have really what's one of the coolest jobs in the world. It's easy for me to some extent to talk about what I do because, you know, everyone kind of likes space. I mean, when you're a kid, it's like space and dinosaurs. Those are the cool things about science.
In a universe of billions of stars, there are billions of mysteries. What is the origin, age, and evolution of the universe?
Planetary science kicked off in the 60s, the 70s, with the first missions to Venus, Mars, humans landing on the moon. We're able to do so much more now. Most people don't know the incredible number of things that, you know, we as a human species are now doing in space and what lies on the horizon. We're able to land car-sized rovers on Mars and then operate them. We're able to send spacecraft to fly by Pluto farther than people would have believed 50 years ago. And we're seeing also this tremendous growth in industry commercially with rockets, with satellites. We're really seeing the democratizing of space exploration. The European Union has a space program. Russia has a space program. Japan just returned a sample from an asteroid. India and China and the United Arab Emirates all have missions orbiting Mars. There are so many countries involved right now. I think we're really becoming a spacefaring society, and it only enhances our exploration. So it's an incredible time to be a space scientist and to be an explorer.
About 16 kilometers from the surface of Mars.
For it is in the quest for such knowledge that science is bringing us closer to an understanding of who and where we are.
One of the most important things as we explore right now is the search for life on other worlds. Whether or not Mars hosted life is the big question. Mars has always been incredibly intriguing because it's been the red planet. It's kind of sticks out in the sky. But when the first flybys were made of Mars, we saw a cratered landscape, kind of like the moon. So it became clear it was old. But then there were these channels, these huge scale features that indicated water. And one of the fascinating things is that we look back into deep time, we look back into the geologic record, we see a Mars that was once far more like Earth. It had lakes, it had rivers, it had Yellowstone-like hydrothermal systems. So the big question is, well, why and what happened to this Mars? And then, did Mars also develop life? Does it still have life? My own research really focuses on using minerals and chemistry of the rocks to trace the history of water. So we're able to see and paint a picture of different habitats on Mars as they existed 3.5 billion years ago. people come to planetary science from all sorts of backgrounds, from physics, from astronomy, from engineering. I come at it as a geologist, meaning I study rocks, but I just happen to study rocks on other planets. I love geology. I love the sense of place, that feeling of the landscape. And as a planetary geologist, that means I get to study, you know, other worlds.
We can look at the planet now, see how its atmosphere is today, try to guess, but really that record is actually recorded and imprinted in the rocks. It's the rocks that record the history.
Planetary exploration really starts with understanding our own planet. I'm looking for a good spot, probably best over here. Try to show the different layers in the rock and the different environments that are recorded. I can tell so many things about the past just by looking at this rock.
You're effectively learning a different language. You're learning a different set of visualizations and characters, and you're learning to read that. There's a record in each and every rock about how it came to be and what the environment was around it when it was formed.
This rock is a really neat one that records the fact that if we had been standing here somewhere between 2 and 5 million years ago, there would have been a giant volcano going off, raining down on us. So we're seeing change. We have to look much deeper in time to see what the planet was like at its beginnings. On a human scale, a long time is, you know, 40 years, 50 years, 100 years. To a geologist, that's the blink of an eye. A long time is maybe a million years, tens of millions of years. The Earth is about 4.6 billion years old, and we're able to peer back deep in time to the very beginnings of our planet. So for Mars, what's really special is it's one of the few planets in our solar system where we're not going there yet as humans, but we can send our robots to do the same thing. They are doing everything that we would do in the field if we were there.
I think science in some ways is a spiritual calling in the sense that there is just an awe at this universe that we live in, at its complexity, at its beauty, and we have the brain to understand it and to make sense of it.
The amazing thing about scientific training is that it teaches you how to answer the why question.
That's what I also try to teach as a professor.
CalTech runs the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, NASA JPL, so it was sort of the best of both worlds. I could be a professor at CalTech and work with the engineers at JPL to explore space.
Our solar system is filled with an amazing, diverse set of 8 planets.
They're all very different from each other, but all of the building blocks are the same. The same chemical elements, minerals, the same ices. But the way you arrange them matters.
Our solar system has 3 planets that, you know, in a cosmic sense, are pretty similar to each other. They're rocky bodies with metal cores, with atmospheres, and that's Venus, Earth, and Mars. Venus is hotter than heck. It is hotter than the boiling point of water on Venus, so it is hard for our spacecraft to survive. But one of the things we want to know is, did Venus have water? Is the water now trapped in the rocks? Is it found in the atmosphere? What happened to Venus? Any water that was once present in the surface is now evaporated. It can only exist as gas. But Mars is Earth's smaller, like, little brother. It's accessible. We can explore it. Most of the missions to Mars, actually, historically, haven't made it. Famously missed Mars. So Mars is hard. Space exploration is hard. But landing a rover on Mars is particularly hard.
In 1997, the first rover, the Sojourner, successfully landed on Mars. It was about, you know, yay big. Next sent in 2004 were the Mars exploration rovers, which are about as tall as a human, about as heavy as three humans. The next generation of rover in 2012, the Curiosity rover, about the size of a Mini Cooper car. We want to travel further, and we want to travel faster.
Touchdown confirmed. Perseverance safely on the surface of Mars.
And finally, the Perseverance, which will not only rove, but it is collecting samples to bring them back to Earth, you know, next step in exploration. If that weren't enough, the 2020 rover also has a helicopter. Our work as scientists begins when the rover lands.
Our mechanical astronauts will take pictures, analyze the soil, sniff the strange air of Mars, feel for moisture. Thus, we will obtain information about Mars from the ground up to the limits of its atmosphere. Perhaps the greatest interest will be in the lander's search for signs of life.
There are literally thousands of places on Mars where we see this record of different kinds of water, different kinds of environments at certain points in time. And the spot that we've picked for the Perseverance rover on Mars is really special to me because it's the Jezero landing site is one of the very first places I studied as a graduate student as I was learning how to be a scientist. We discovered this beautiful Lake Delta. And then outside of Jezero, one of the most ancient stratigraphies on Mars, 4 billion years old. I think it's a spectacular choice. We get to embark on this great traverse, collecting samples along the way that really reveal the history during this early critical period. Believe it or not, there's actually a pretty mundane routine to operating a rover. The rover doesn't like to drive until later in the day. So typically it wakes up and needs time to warm up. And we have about an hour before the rover drives to do science.
Encryption will be one topic.
My day-to-day is mostly meeting with people, you know, talking about what we do, where we go.
Yeah, we're in agreement on that.
And on the phone are the scientists in charge of the water detector from Russia. My other science colleague, a volcanologist who studies volcanoes, is on the line telling us where to point the camera. The folks from Spain are telling us what sequences they want to run on their environmental sensor. So it's really a global collaboration. All right, I guess we should do some work, right? I'm showing you what I actually do. So yeah, how we know the composition of planets is by the type of data that I'm showing you here. This is an infrared image of Mars taken by a spacecraft called CRISM, and this is the landing site of the Perseverance rover. This is the Jezero Delta that we're going to be exploring for the next few years. So here I'm showing you clays and carbonates in the sediments that make up this delta. So this is where we are now. This is where the rover is. These rock layers off a few kilometers in the distance are what we're going to be driving to. A rover on Mars is very slow. It goes 100 meters a day. Now, you know, a sprinter covers that in 10 seconds. They are continually computing their way through terrain using stereo cameras on either side of the mast to take images, collecting samples as we go. Occasionally, we are able to make discoveries that, you know, are worth sharing, and it's like really exciting. The reality, though, is that those discoveries are made usually in fractions. And often what's reported is the product of a year or two of work. The scientific community has been recommending that we bring samples back from Mars for over 40 years. And then the set of missions starting with the Perseverance rover to collect those samples, later missions that will happen this decade to bring them back, were put in motion by hundreds of people and decades of planning.
we have to be, you know, really patient because planetary science missions take a lot of resources, they take a lot of people, they take many years to develop, and then oftentimes they take many years to get to their destinations, even once they're launched and off the planet. In the outer solar system, you know, transit times to get there are 7 to 12 years, and that's after you've launched and, you know, after you've already spent 10 years building the craft. So, you know, thinking on that long-term time scale is super important to me.
I'm driven to explore space because I like the exploration. I'm curious. I want to know how planets work. Other people are driven by just the sheer excitement. They want to be a space tourist, or they're driven by profit. They want to be the first company to mine water on the moon and use that water for rocket fuel. So I think all of these ideas can coexist in space. It doesn't sort of freak me out that this is happening. It's the next transformation in our society. It's going to the final frontier, and that frontier right now is in space. But I think as the commercial side of space exploration grows, as the number of nations involved grows, there is a real need right now to really come to agreement as a species about what the ground rules should be. Because, you know, historically, exploration has turned into exploitation. I hope we've learned from that. We want to tread lightly. We want to understand the system and what we see, the landscape, rather than destroying it, right? I feel a sense of obligation and care as we explore to protect those places that we visit. By exploring these sister worlds, we really learn something about how fragile the balance can be between the climate of a planet and the conditions that support life or not. I think if Mars once had life, it probably still has life today, but it will be very hard to find because the surface right now is harsh. Climate change happened on Mars. Climate change also happened on Venus, where we have this hellish greenhouse atmosphere. You know, one of the things that we're facing right now is climate change on Earth. And it's not so much that the climate is changing. Earth will be here. The Earth's climate has changed many times. But what's different now is the pace, the rate at which the climate is changing. It's changing at a rate that's faster than most life can keep up. This teeming web of this ecosystem of life that has evolved to be in balance with the climate that we have now, not this rapidly changing on the scale of decades. So there's really a sense that I get by thinking about long time, by thinking about natural pacing of change, how really fragile it is that we've hit the balance on Earth for life, and it's here right now, and we don't want to lose that. One of the things I acutely appreciate as a planetary scientist is how special our world really is. Across all of the many bodies of our solar system, across what we've been able to see so far, we know of exactly one planet that for 4 billion years has had life on it. Our planet has changed over those years, but it has been an abode of life in the universe. And we're trying to figure out why. So in looking outward into space, there's also looking back inward to what we need to do to keep our planet and its web of life intact.